house with me wet. Let the car heater dry me on the way to wherever, and I'll still make you look good hair. I wanted the kind of hair that would cascade down my back like rivers of water. The kind of hair that made Solomon sit down and pen the book of songs. The kind of hair that children could play in, and with just a few shakes of my head would be in perfect order again. The kind of hair that would stop men dead in their tracks because they were so mesmerized by the luxuriousness of my hair that they would fantasize just about touching it. But I didn't have that kind of hair. Honey, my hair is like what a baby's kid. Sure, you could wash it, but you wouldn't dare leave it, the house with it wet, because it would make the whole house look tore up from the floor up. But when your hair looked like that, ain't no man stopping dead in his tracks because he's fantasizing. Plus, I don't know a sister who, after sitting in the shop for 2+ hours, getting fried, dyed, and laid to the side, would have anybody's child playing up in her hair. So I resigned myself to being stuck with my nappy, thick, rough, classified as not good. Took the strength of Samson to comb through it hair. The, ooh, I was having a good day until I had to deal with you hair, the Jesus. Are you sure you love me? Because you know you gave me this hair. But one day, I had an epiphany. I thought, instead of cursing my hair, that I would just go directly to the source and have a little talk with Jesus and express to him the finer points and sundries of my daily dilemma. I was convinced that after he heard my woeful plea, that he would see my point of view and change the texture of my hair post-haste. Child, I got so excited at the idea of it, I started flipping my hair around in anticipation of the answered prayer, because I heard a preacher say, if you can see it, then you can have it. And baby, I saw it, so I knew I was going to get it. And I had read in the Bible where it said that faith without works is dead. And I had the faith, so I knew he was going to perform the work. Can I get an amen? But instead of changing the texture of my hair, he changed my thoughts about my hair. He helped me to see that first and foremost, he never, ever, ever makes mistakes. And that my hair was really a lot like me, because it's strong, yet soft, fragile, but resilient, constant, yet versatile, beautiful, but dangerous when not handled with care. Like me, it can be demure and feminine, touchable but sometimes aloof. It can be sophisticated and elegant one day, and then innocent and childlike the next. And yes, when you catch it on a bad day, it is stubborn and unmovable. But 90% of the time, it's really flexible and yielding. My hair also serves as a constant reminder to me of my uniqueness, because there is no other race of people on the face of the earth with hair like mine. Therefore, that automatically elevates me to rare. And we all know what's rare is priceless. Honey, by the time God got done explaining to me his finer points and sundries, I had no choice but to make peace with my hair. So I made a promise to God. No longer would I kill it with chemicals or subject it to unrelenting heat for prolonged periods of time. Instead, I would treasure it, pamper it, nurture it, but more importantly, free it from the prison of making it something God never designed it to be. Because now, I can clearly see that God designed my hair for my glory.